Lord, for your goodness and your faithfulness in our lives.
God.
All my life you have
just in the stillness of your heart, you and the King, offer him up a thanksgiving of praise from your heart. Worship him together. Worship him in your heart. Let him know how much you love him. Thank him for his goodness, for he is truly so, so good to us. Thank you for his faithfulness, for he truly is faithful to us. Thank you for his abounding love and mercy. Thank him for his holiness, because without holiness, there is really nothing, nothing that is good. And so we thank you, God, for your holiness. Just worship him this way. Offer up your praises to him. Thank you, Father. May you be blessed, O King, by what you heard this morning. We give you praise in Jesus' holy name. And God's people said together, amen, amen. Thank you, worship team. That was stunning.
Already five, stunningly beautiful. To 11. Does that mean I've got okay. A time frame? That's, no. We've got to beat Gateway out to lunch, right? That's always the struggle. That's why we start at 10 and they start at 10:30 so we can beat them to L&W. We are continuing our way in the Gospel of Matthew. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Matthew chapter 7. Last week, we thank you for your prayers over the weekend. We took 21 youth to Disturbing the Peace Youth Conference in Grand Prairie. And what an awesome time it was. It was exhausting. I think the first night I got 3 hours of sleep. The next night, I think it was 5 or 6. But we survived and had a blast. And you know what? God is at work. Even among teenagers. Especially among youth and teenagers. You know, we live in this, you know, this day and age where so much has changed with social media, with this digital age. And, you know, I found that youth can multitask so much better than I can. So much better than I can. It's they're doing one thing and you're thinking, oh, they're like so far away from actually being engaged. And then they say something and it's like, oh, that's awesome. One thing that I heard from a youth this weekend was, I really want my faith to be authentic. That's what we should all want. I saw a youth that had no faith background, never been to church, engaging in a time of worship that maybe they didn't even realize what all was going on. They were engaging. They were a part of it. So thank you for your prayers. Continue being in prayer for the youth of our town. We had 36 at Alpha this past Tuesday, coming over from the high school at lunchtime, able to pray for them as we talked about what does it mean to receive the Holy Spirit. And again, watching them engage with it. And I'm learning more and more to celebrate the engagement with faith, the engagement with Christ, where it's the, I don't really know what all this is, but I'm gonna try it out. I'm gonna see what it's all about. I'm gonna stop. And in your room with 36 youth, there was complete silence as Pastor Logan prayed over them and prayed for them. God is at work. That has nothing to do with the message this morning, but I just wanted to update you and thank you for your prayers and to challenge you to continue to be in prayer for the youth of our town. So, all right. Father God, we thank you so much that you are continually at work, even when we don't see it. But we thank you for the times we get to see it and we get to be a part of it. Thank you for the 21 youth that went this past weekend to a youth conference. I thank you for the 36 plus that we have seen through Alpha. Thank you for the 60 plus students we see every week at Hot Dog Lunch. These opportunities that you have provided for us as a church to reach out with your love. And sometimes it's just a hello. Sometimes it's just you matter enough that we're going to give you a hot dog. Sometimes it's the opportunity to pray. Sometimes it's seeing them engage with faith for the first time. So, Father, would you continue to work? Would you continue to pour out your spirit on these high schools in this town? The world is such a mess. And there are so many voices screaming at these youth through social media, through school, through all teacher, whatever it is, all these voices screaming. Father, I pray that your still, small voice would drown them all out. That the peace, the hope, the joy, the identity that they are searching for, that they would see that it only comes through you. I pray that you would empower us, embolden us to remain faithful in what you're calling us to. I thank you for the volunteers, the leaders that step up, that don't get paid to go away for a weekend with youth, but do it with a smile on their face. For those that show up week in and week out to make hot dogs, I thank you. And I praise you for the work that you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, we are finishing up the Sermon on the Mount. We have been on this journey where Jesus has shown up and he said, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and this is what it looks like. He has taken first century Judaism and their thoughts, their religious ideas of how this is supposed to work out, and he's flipped them on its head. And in reality, flip things right side up again, how they were always meant to be. He's clarified what true blessing is. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessed are those who suffer, who are persecuted. He's clarified true righteousness as not being about necessarily your outward actions, but more truly what is going on in your heart. He's talked to us about true kingdom living, what our lives should look like when they are truly impacted by the kingdom of heaven. True kingdom relationships, what our relationships should look like. And much to the dismay of the religious leaders of his day, this didn't quite line up with their thinking. And those who were listening and those of us today who are listening to his words, we are left with a choice. What are we going to do with what Jesus says? This really earth-shattering, topsy-turvy message of the kingdom of heaven, what are we going to do with it? It flies in the face of what this world teaches. It flies in the face of what so many people say. What are we going to do with his words? To jump ahead a little bit, after he finished the Sermon on the Mount, in verse 28 of chapter 7, it says, when Jesus finished these sayings, the crowds were astonished at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as their scribes. You see, back in the day, the scribes, the religious leaders, they would always point to someone else's teachings. A rabbi would be of the school of another rabbi. And they say, well, this is what this rabbi taught. It all would be pointing to another man's authority. But Jesus came preaching with authority. He came not saying, well, this might be the way, or possibly this could be a way, but he came preaching with authority. He came saying, this is the way, the truth, and the life. And so it forces us to make a decision. Because either we're going to embrace and accept what Jesus said with authority and with sureness, or we're not. What are we going to do with the teachings of Jesus? And that's how he closes the Sermon on the Mount. That's where he closes this morning, as he shows us two choices, two options I should say, two options as we look at what we're going to do with Jesus. And he presents us with two gates, two trees, and two foundations, illustrating this choice that we have. Two gates, two trees, and two foundations. He starts out, if you have your Bible, look with me, chapter 7. We're going to start in verse 13. He says, "Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction. And those who enter by it are many, for the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. And those who find it are few." This is a hard one to wrestle with. Thanks a lot, Kevin. No. This is a tough one. This is one that makes you squirm a little bit. It is true. Jesus says, enter by the narrow gate. And then he proceeds to describe the two gates. The first one is wide. The way is broad. It's comfortable. It's easy. It's one that doesn't take a lot of effort to travel. It doesn't require us to change. It lets us live our truth. It lets us pursue what we want to pursue. And many find it. This is the tragedy of it. It is so easy, it is so comfortable, it is so broad that many find it. And it leads to destruction. But then he describes the second gate. The second gate is very different. It is narrow. He says that the way is hard and few find it. It is a way that is marked by oppression and affliction. And we don't like those things. This path requires us to deny ourselves. It requires us to deny our own ideas, our own desires, what we think is best. And few find it. And this should give us pause. Let's not rush past this. Let it have its full effect, because again, Jesus was speaking with authority here, and he was saying, this is the reality. This is the reality of this narrow path that leads to life. This is the reality of what the world offers you in this broad and easy path, yet it leads to destruction. The path that Jesus is offering here isn't full of sunshine and daisies. If you're looking for a path of comfort and ease, that's not the path that Jesus calls us to. But if you want life, true, abundant, eternal life, it's the narrow path. You see, taking this path, going through this narrow gate, is recognizing and embracing that this world and all that it offers is fallen and broken due to sin. The path that it is on is a path of destruction, and Jesus has provided a way out. He has provided a way out of destruction into life. But it isn't a path of self-reliance. It isn't a path of self-realization or self-actualization. It is a path of laying ourselves aside and saying, Jesus, I need you and you alone. It is a path that is in complete contradiction to the path that this world is on. You see, this world tells us to find your own truth. Look within yourself to find the way. But Jesus has been setting up this whole time the path of righteousness, the path to the kingdom of heaven. It isn't a path that you can tread on your own. This isn't a path that we can find on our own. This isn't a path that we can make on our own. It is a path that only he can lead us on. And this isn't judgmental legalism that shakes his head and wags its finger when we do something wrong. But this is an invitation of Jesus saying, look, The path that will lead to destruction is wide and easy. Don't get caught in it. But there is a way that leads to life. And this is an invitation of Jesus, come and follow me on this path. Enter by the narrow gate. Choose Jesus. You see, we live in this, really this pluralistic society that tells us that one way or another, it doesn't matter as long as you eventually get there. Choose what feels right for you. Decide for yourself what truth you're going to stand on, based on your own thoughts, your own feelings, your own desires. And as Jesus comes to the end of this sermon, he's saying, no, there's one way, and it's a narrow path. And we're left with this choice. We're left with this choice to make. And just as those voices are coming through the door, we aren't left just on our own making this choice without any other influence. There are a million voices screaming at us. A million voices out there telling us, come this way. Do this, do that, believe this, believe that. And Jesus knows this. And he talks about this. He goes on in this, starting and picking it up back in verse 15. He says, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will recognize them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? So every healthy tree bears good fruit, but the diseased tree bears bad fruit. A healthy tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a diseased tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus you will recognize them by their fruits. Beware. Watch out. Be on the lookout. Be diligent. Because there's false prophets standing at the entrance to the wide and easy gate. And they know what they're doing. Here's a couple things that we are told about these false prophets. First, it says they come to us in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. Wolves in sheep's clothing. I often would hear this and I would think of like a wolf covered in wool. And it's kind of a funny image because it's like, oh, well, obviously that's a wolf. Like you can cover a wolf in some wool and you can tell it's a wolf, right? It's not very deceptive. But let's look at what it's saying here. It's saying they are in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. Sheep's clothing, they're wearing wool. They look like a shepherd. They look like someone who cares for sheep. They look like a shepherd who is leading you to green pastures, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. Here's why it takes diligence when it comes to false prophets, false teachers, false doctrine. Here's why Jesus is saying, beware. Because it looks good. It wears the clothing of a shepherd who promises to lead you to green pastures. We're told that Satan comes as an angel of light. So why would we expect his henchmen to do something different? They look like shepherds, but inwardly they are like ravenous wolves. So how do we discern? How do we tell which is the right path? Which teacher should I follow? Which should I listen to? Jesus tells us, look at their fruit. He asks some pretty obvious questions. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes? No. Are figs gathered from thistles? No. Does a diseased tree bear good, healthy fruit? No. It's these kind of, almost like, duh, You don't go looking for fruit in places where fruit doesn't grow. If a tree is bearing good fruit, you can make the fair assumption that the tree is good. If there's no fruit, or if it's diseased fruit, then you can tell a lot about the tree, a lot about the plant that it's coming from. Is it good fruit? This is what Jesus is telling us. You will know them by their fruit. And it takes some work. Again, it takes diligence. Jesus says this is a hard path. It isn't one of ease. It's staying diligent because the enemy is at work. And he is the father of all lies. And he is seeking to deceive. And so Jesus says, be diligent. Look for their fruit. And so we have to ask, what is the fruit that we are to look for? What is the good, healthy fruit in comparison to the diseased fruit? What fruit are we looking for? We pick it up in verse 21. He says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do mighty works in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. Again, a tough one to wrestle with. Again, thanks, Kevin. When we look at their fruit, what is the fruit that comes from one who is living the kingdom, who has embraced the kingdom of heaven, who is preaching the kingdom of heaven? We break this down, we look at what is not fruit. Mere simple words. You see, these people, they come to Jesus and say, Lord, Lord. They know the right things to say. They know the right words to say. They know the Christianese. They know all the right words to say to make you think that they have it all together. So we can't just look at their words. We have to look at the fruit of their lives. Simple and mere words don't reveal fruit. It's like that nice green foliage that really is covering over diseased fruit. Another thing that is not fruit, simply claiming to prophesy, cast out demons, and do mighty works. These guys come to Jesus and say, Lord, didn't we do these things? Didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we cast out demons? Didn't we do these mighty works in your name? And Jesus says, I never knew you. Mighty works aren't necessarily fruit of the kingdom of heaven. But he says that the true fruit is doing the will of the Father. We're going to camp out here for a little bit because I think especially in our digital age, this is something we really have to pay attention to. Because we have access through the great World Wide Web to a wide variety of teachings out there. And there are some really good ones out there. There are some really good preachers and teachers out there. And there are some really bad ones. And we need to be diligent, church. Is the teaching that we're listening to, are the words that we are receiving, are they of the kingdom of heaven? Or are they from the kingdom of darkness? We need to look at the fruit. Remember where Jesus is when he preaches this. First century Palestine. Speaking with Jews, calling out the religious leaders, saying, they're saying one thing, but living a different way. They've turned things upside down, and Jesus is writing them again. He's calling out these religious leaders, and he's going to continue to do so as we work our way through the rest of Matthew, calling them whitewashed tombs, false shepherds, things like that, being full of death. These guys looked on the outside like they were doing everything right, but when it came to following God, they had missed it. And Jesus is warning his listeners, and he's warning us today, be careful, be watchful. Look for the fruit. So, church, let's remember what isn't fruit. Before I move on, I just want to say, don't just look for this in internet preachers or those that you listen to online. Look for this in Pastor Kevin and I as well. I feel like I can throw him under the bus because I know he feels the same way. The fruit of our lives should match the kingdom of heaven. This is absolutely, if you move on and you go to a different church, if you move towns and you're looking for a church, if you're looking at the pastors, be diligent, be watchful. Look for the fruit of the kingdom or the lives of those teaching, those that you are putting yourself under their teaching, those who are leading you, are their lives reflecting the fruit of the kingdom? Because what isn't fruit is mere words. It's easy to get up and say the right thing. It's easy to get up and couch your words in what you know people want to hear. Satan knows this book inside and out. He used it against Jesus when he tempted Jesus in the wilderness, and he uses it today. Watch out for their words, because it's easy to take and cherry pick verses out and conform them to the message that you want to say, as opposed to saying, what does Scripture teach? And also, what isn't fruit is a claim for mighty works. And this is hard, because we do see gifts of the Spirit in Scripture. We do see prophecy. We do see healing. We do see these amazing gifts of the Spirit that he pours on his church. But let's make sure that we differentiate between the works of the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit. When we're looking for what is of the kingdom of heaven, let's make sure we are looking for the fruit that Jesus tells us to look for. And it isn't always the mighty works. It isn't always the claims to prophecy that people make. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 3, we're told of the fruit of these false prophets, these false teachers. Peter says in 2 Peter chapter 2, but false prophets also arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the master who bought them, bringing upon themselves swift destruction. And many will follow their sensuality, and because of them, the way of truth will be blasphemed. And in their greed, they will exploit you with false words. Their condemnation from long ago is not idle, and their destruction is not asleep. Two things that mark the false teacher. One is sensuality. The Greek word, I'm going to butcher the pronunciation, eselgies, something like that. I'm taking Greek in the fall, so you can ask me more then about Greek. But it means licentiousness. I had to look up that word too. I had an idea of what it meant, but Merriam-Webster, he describes it as excessive transgressive freedom. Excessive transgressive freedom. It's taking liberty. I can live however I want. I can do whatever I want. Look at the life of the teachers of those that you are following. It's when all manner of excuses are given for sin, whether it's sexual sin, which sensuality often is referring to, or whether it's anger, abuse, lying, deception. It's this idea that because somebody is a teacher, or they say they're a prophet, or whatever it is, that they have freedom to live however they want, and we can't question them because of their office. Jesus says, no, test their fruit. Look at their life. It's this idea that they can get away with bullying, with abusing those underneath them, can get away with money laundering and unwanted advances on women, or even rape. And I wish that I was over-exaggerating, but I'm not. This is a reality. Are their lives marked by sensuality? The second is exploitation. It says that they will exploit you with false words. This word refers to being in trade or business, or to make merchandise. Now, I have to recognize that I've got to be careful as I walk this path here, because I am a paid pastor, and I really appreciate that I get to do my job and get paid for it. Scripture, I do believe, and again, it maybe sounds a little bit weird me saying this, do believe makes room for paying pastors, and I'm immensely blessed by this. But what is the heart behind it? You see, the line gets crossed when the motive becomes greed, the desire for wealth and financial prosperity through the preaching of the word. We looked how Jesus already said, do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroys. And this is a call for all of us as believers, but especially as we look to our leaders, as we look to the pastors and teachers, are they laying up for themselves treasures on earth? Are they exploiting the gospel for their own gain? We need to test for these things. We need to look for this fruit. We looked last week at the wrong way to judge. The hypocritical, looking down on, wagging our finger. That's not what Jesus is calling us to here. He is calling us to be careful, to be watchful, to test by the fruit that he tells us to. As we look at these teachers, is there marks of licentiousness? We find them on the internet. Let's do a little bit of research and let's be diligent, church, about who we're actually listening to. Are they marked by controversy? Are they marked by claims, valid claims of sexual misconduct? Unfortunately, this is far too common in the church. This isn't to say that pastors are perfect. Pastors are human, they mess up, but is it a covering up? Or are they dealing with it? Are they admitting to their sin? Are they seeking restoration and resolution? Are they repentant in their hearts? Or are excuses made? Do cover-ups happen? And then check for exploitation. One thing I often do, this isn't a fail-proof, but I'm trying to get a little bit more practical this morning. One thing I do with different teachers that I hear about is I'll Google their name and net worth. Are they building for themselves a kingdom on earth? And again, this isn't foolproof. I'm trying not to, you know, get too specific because we've got to be careful here, but we're looking for fruit. We're looking for the fruit of their lives. Are they building for themselves a kingdom here on earth? Are all of their teachings ending with, now send me a check? Do all of their videos end with, and here's how you can support my ministry? As you look to their websites, is it all about them? Are they building a kingdom of themselves, or are they building the kingdom of God? Jesus says, or sorry, Peter says, their condemnation from long ago is not idle and their destruction is not asleep. Church, I don't want to be perceived as calling people out, as being harsh, but be careful, church. Be careful, because it is so easy. The path is broad and easy that leads to destruction. And the false prophets that stand at the doorway, they look good. They are good at what they do. They are so deceptive. We have to remain diligent. The fruit of the kingdom of God, the fruit that Jesus tells us to look for is, are they doing the will of the Father? We need to test everything they do by the word of God. God's told us what he's up to. He's told us how. He hasn't left us in the dark. This isn't the narrow path that Jesus says, have fun finding on your own and traversing on your own. But no, it's one that he leads and guides us. He, as the good shepherd, leads us down this path. But we have to remain diligent. Does their character reflect the fruit that we're told in Scripture marks a person who is being led by the Spirit? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Are our leaders' lives marked by these things? James 3:1 says, "Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness." This is sobering because I get up here and I know that I mess up. I am not perfect. And sometimes I need to be called out on my junk. Those who stand in positions of authority, those who are teaching and preaching the word of God are to be held to a greater standard. And we need to remain diligent as we listen to teaching, as we put ourselves under that teaching. Are we checking for the fruit? Or are we just looking for what tickles our ear? Are we just looking for things that we like to hear? We come to the end of the passage of math in this sermon by Jesus, and we're told of two houses built on two different foundations, our final pair here. I have to tell this story, a little bit of a humorous break, comedic break. So my mother-in-law, she wouldn't be offended if I share this. One day she was with our kids, and she started telling them the story of the three little pigs. And she said the first little pig, he built his house on the rock, and the second little pig built his house on the sand. And then she realized something isn't right here, and there's a mixing of stories here. So we're not talking about the three little pigs this morning, though I'm sure there's some lessons we can learn from them. We're talking about two foundations. And this is where it comes down to this choice. Are we going to plant our flag, build our house on the foundation of Jesus Christ and Him alone? Are we going to listen to His voice, His word, and Him alone? Are we going to trust when He says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father except through me"? Because listen to what He says. He says, "Everyone who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had found a foundation on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it." Two houses being built on two different foundations. You notice in the building of them, they're both being built. You can't necessarily tell what's going on underneath. You can't tell from the beginning, is this a sure foundation? Is this a solid foundation? Both houses being built, our lives being built, and the question is, what foundation are we building on? And there's two ways I think we should look at this. First is the storms of life. Listen, church, the storms of life will come. We all live in this world. We all recognize there are hardships, there are calamities, there is disaster, there's sickness, there are broken relationships. When these things happen, do we crumble? Because here's the great hope that we have in Christ, is that when we build our life on Him, even though the wind comes, even though the rain comes and the floods come, our house will stay secure because it's built on the sure foundation of Jesus Christ. But if we build our life on any other foundation, it is like the sand that is washed away. And in the end, the final judgment that Jesus alludes to, just what we just looked at the very end, there will only be one question. What did you do with Jesus? Did you build your life on the sure foundation of Jesus Christ, or did you choose something else? Did you look at Him as the foundation of your life, or simply an add-on to add to the mix? When Jesus finished these sayings, the crowds were astonished at His teaching, for He was teaching them as one who had authority. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to Jesus Christ. He is the King that sits on the throne. He is the beginning and the end. All things were created through Him and by Him, and not one thing was created apart from Him. He is the founder and the perfecter of our faith. He is the way, the truth, and the life. The way is narrow. The way is one person, and that's Jesus Christ. Broad is the way. Wide and easy is the path that leads to destruction. But Jesus is inviting us as the good shepherd, not as a sheep in sheep's clothing, but as the true good shepherd saying, follow me and I'll lead you on this path. Trust in me, depend on me, surrender your life and follow me. If you've never done this, if you're here this morning, if you have never trusted in Jesus, he is inviting you today. Say, Jesus, I'm giving up my old way of doing things. I'm giving up my own ideas, my own thoughts, the lies of this world, and I am choosing to follow you. For those of you who walk with Jesus, it's easy for us to get distracted. It's easy for us to start looking over the fence at that broad road, getting closer and closer to the edge, peering over. And we get distracted. Are we being diligent? Are we being watchful? Let's trust that he has given us all we need for life and godliness. We just have to listen. Listen to him. Listen to his voice. Test the fruit. Test everything you hear by his word and trust. He is leading us on the path of life. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you. I thank you that you have not left us alone. You have not left us alone on this path, on the pathway of destruction. But you have provided a way, the way to life. And so, Father, would you help us? This is a narrow path. This is the hard path. This is the difficult path, but we do not walk it alone. You as our good shepherd lead and guide us. And so would we listen for your voice, Jesus. Would you help us as the million other voices in this world seek to drown yours out? Would we listen for your voice? Would we trust your word that you've given us? That our life would be built on the sure foundation of Jesus. We thank you and we pray this in his powerful name. Amen.